here this morning with the spirit of expectation that he's going to do something in your life? Come on and sing with me. Good morning. I'd invite you to have a seat for a moment. Good to see everyone here. If you're visiting with us, I should introduce myself. My name is Kevin. I'm the discipleship pastor here at Linwood. Our senior pastor is with a group of folks from our church in Honduras today. Flew down yesterday. The report is that they got there safely and will be traveling deeper into the country today as they prepare to minister there all week. So definitely want to pray for them. Here, I'm very honored to have the opportunity to share with you from Jonah chapter 4 this morning as we finish up the sermon series called Going Deep that Pastor Mark has led us through for some time. So we're very happy to have you here with us. If you are visiting, we do have one request. In the pew in front of you, there's a card. We call it a Connect card. If you wouldn't mind to pull that out, fill it out for us so we can get to know who you are, have an opportunity to minister to you and your family. We'd appreciate that. Also, for anyone on that same card is an opportunity for you to write down a prayer request. We have people who are praying during the service this morning. We also pray for those during the week, so we'd invite you to take that opportunity to write a prayer request on there. And here in just a short while, it'll be obvious to you when that comes, there'll be a time for you to pass those to the center of the aisle, and we'll pick them up. But right now, why don't we all stand and we'll greet one another.
I'm Wendy Durham. Here's what's going on around Linwood. Charge discipleship courses have begun, but it's not too late to get in on a class. In fact, there are some new ones beginning March 1st. Here's a preview of one.
I think a lot of people are afraid to witness and ask people about their salvation because they're afraid that they'll ask them something they don't know.
And this is the sin that most of us as Christians commit on a daily basis, that we fail to say something to somebody about the gospel of Christ. We as Christians can't just stand by and live our lives and think that that's going to be enough.
There's a radically different dynamic when you open the Word of God than when you do not. And it's a very simple way that I have learned to open the Bible, present it to the non-believer, where they cannot argue with me.
I don't necessarily feel called to go out and shout it, but I need to be available to those people that God brings into my life and that I have a relationship to speak to them about what is so real and is so has changed my life and makes my life worth living.
I handed her a couple of $100. I was arrested for buying stolen merchandise, and my bond was $250,000.
He was just a nasty guy. He was exploitive of people. He really didn't care about anybody but himself.
Is that you never can tell whose life God is working in, whose life God is drawing to Jesus.
To learn more about this and many other studies available, visit linwoodbc.org/charge. We are excited to announce the release of our brand new Linwood Church app for your mobile device. With the new Linwood app, you'll be able to catch up on full-length services or audio podcasts. You'll be able to learn about the exciting ministries going on at Linwood and see the church calendar. We're even including the Wednesday night supper menu for each week. You'll be able to connect with our staff, fill out a connect card if you're a visitor, let us know about a prayer request, or find your spot to serve. It will also offer a brand new online giving platform called PushPay. With online giving, you'll be able to give at your convenience, manage a reoccurring gift, or see your online giving records whenever you choose. All of these features and many more are available from inside our new Linwood app. You can download the new app by visiting your device's app store and searching for Linwood. Or if you'd like a little help, you can visit the guest services desk after the service, and someone will be there to help show you all the great features in our new app. We think this will be an exciting new way for you to stay connected to all that is going on around our church. Leading your children along the pathway of spirituality can be tricky. That's why here at Linwood, we use the milestone strategy to help you know where you are going and how to get there by providing support, encouragement, and resources for the journey. Here's our student pastor, Jeff Moran, to tell you a little about the fourth milestone, Purity for Life, and talk with you about the Purity for Life conference coming up on March 18th.
Hey church, the Purity for Life conference is coming Saturday, March 18th from 9:30 a.m. to 2 p.m. in the afternoon in the youth room. This free conference is for students in grades 7 through 12 and their parents to attend together. You know, God calls us to be holy as He is holy. So in this conference, we're going to talk about issues such as what is your identity in Christ and friendships and how they affect our purity and our holiness. We're going to talk about dating relationships and following God's plan for sex. So I hope, parents, that you will come and bring your student. It's important for you to be there because this gives you an opportunity to talk about those issues together and have conversations about that together. So I hope to see you there March 18th in the youth room.
Also, we should mention that the Century Kid registration has been extended through today. If you'd still like to register your child for Century Kid today, you can go to linwoodbc.org/children. As always, for more information on these announcements and much more, log on to linwoodbc.org. And if you're a guest with us this morning, please remember to stop by the guest services desk out in the foyer for your free gift. And welcome to Linwood.
Let's all stand together. Let's lift our voices. Let's sing about surrendering to Him.
With this heart open wide, from the depth, from the height, I will bring a sacrifice. With these hands lifted high, I will bring a sacrifice. I will bring
We see.
this morning is that the Lamb has overcome and He's alive. And Father, we thank You for that truth, that we can gather today to worship a risen Savior, a Savior who has brought to us salvation, who's died for us. God, help us to live our lives in a manner that's worthy of that. Father, I pray that as we look into Your word this morning, which is living and active, that we would not only hear it, but that we would receive it, and that we would allow it to speak into our hearts. That Your Holy Spirit would have that teaching ministry amongst us this morning, that we would learn. God, help us as we worship You through the reading of Your word and the study of it. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, I've already shared with you that what I want to do this morning is wrap up the sermon series from Jonah. So if you have your Bible, take it and turn with me to Jonah, chapter 4. Jonah chapter 4. Pastor Mark has been preaching, teaching through the book of Jonah for a few weeks now. And we've seen this story play itself out, as God has taught us much from that. I'll tell you, I have rarely been so conflicted having an opportunity to share. On one hand, I'm always very thankful and very grateful to Pastor Mark and the opportunities that he gives me to share from his word and to share with you, whether you call that teaching or preaching or whatever word you might use for that. I'm grateful for the opportunity. But I've rarely been so unhappy to speak on a particular text as I am Jonah chapter 4. Let me try to explain that. Let me say what I don't mean by that. I don't mean by that Jonah chapter 4 is somehow deficient and that there's really nothing in here that can be taught. I don't mean that at all. It's the authoritative word of God. There's much here. I don't mean that it's overly difficult to understand, because it's not. There's much here that we can learn, that we can apply to our lives as we look into God's word. I mean by that, as I studied it and read Jonah chapter 4, I found myself thinking, why is this even in here? Because when you read chapter 3 and you come to the end of the story, or so it seems the end of the story, it appears like God has put a nice bow on this story of Jonah, and it should end right there. Let me remind you what Jonah chapter 3 verse 10 says. Mark preached on this last week. I'm not going to go through all that again, but I do want to read chapter 3 verse 10 as an introduction to chapter 4. Then God saw their actions, that they had turned from their evil ways. So God relented from the disaster He had threatened to do to them, and He did not do it. Isn't that a great way to end the book of Jonah? I mean, don't you read that thinking, hey, that's great. That's good news. The people have repented. I mean, even from a storytelling perspective, this is a story worthy of an Oscar. I mean, here's the hero of our story, Jonah, in chapter 1, receiving a mission, not being sure, however, that he wanted to fulfill the mission, wrestling with that a little bit, and coming to the conclusion that rather than to fulfill God's purpose for his life, he's going to run from it and do his own thing. And so he gets up and leaves the physical location of that and ultimately ends up on a ship and decides, just throw me over, I'll just die, and that'll be the end of this. So he has this existential struggle with who he is. That's worthy of Hollywood, right? And then in chapter 2, as he gets thrown overboard, God sends this fish, which some people interpret as an act of God's judgment, but really it was an act of God's grace. God sends the fish to rescue Jonah. And so we have this scene perfect for special effects. And then in chapter 3, after Jonah comes to this conclusion inside the belly of the fish that, hey, I need to fulfill God's purpose, I'm willing to do that, he changes. He comes out, he gets vomited up in chapter 3, goes and does what he's supposed to do. He preaches to the Ninevites, he tells the truth to them, and they repent. God relents from his wrath, and the story ends. And the credits roll, and we all feel really good about that. But there's chapter 4. And you wonder, why is there chapter 4? Well, it's there because God has much to say yet. There's so much more that we need to learn and understand. And I was in a conversation this morning, earlier this morning, thinking through the service, and Gabe was in the meeting with us, and we were talking about this particular passage and this particular issue, and he made a great observation. He said, you know, in a lot of ways, it's kind of like the first three chapters is like the movie, and chapter 4 is the bonus features on the Blu-ray. You ever rent a movie or go buy a movie, a Blu-ray movie, and you watch it and you enjoy it, and you're like, you know, I want more of this. I want to find out kind of what went behind the scenes in the story and how they accomplished this and why they did this way. Chapter 4 is kind of like that. Because in chapter 4, we get to see behind the scenes, among other things, that we see that the story never was about Jonah to begin with. It was always about God and why God did what God did. So let's read chapter 4 and see what we can learn this great truth from God's Word. Jonah chapter 4. I'm going to actually pick up in verse 10 again for context and then read the whole of chapter 4. Then God saw their actions, that they had turned from their evil ways. So God relented from the disaster he had threatened to do to them, and he did not do it. But Jonah was greatly displeased and became furious. He prayed to the Lord, "Please, Lord, isn't this what I said while I was still in my own country? That's why I fled toward Tarshish in the first place. I knew that you were a merciful and compassionate God, slow to become angry, rich in faithful love, and one who relents from sending disaster. And now, Lord, please take my life from me, for it's better for me to die than to live." The Lord asked, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Jonah left the city and sat down east of it. He made himself a shelter there and sat in its shade to see what would happen to the city. Then the Lord God appointed a plant, and it grew up to provide shade over Jonah's head to ease his discomfort. Jonah was greatly pleased with the plant. Verse 7, when dawn came the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the plant, and it withered. As the sun was rising, God appointed a scorching east wind. The sun beat down so much on Jonah's head that he almost fainted, and he wanted to die. He said, "It's better for me to die than to live." And then God asked Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" "Yes," he replied, "it is right. I'm angry enough to die." So the Lord said, "You cared about the plant, which you did not labor over and did not grow. It appeared in the night and perished in the night. Should I not care about the great city of Nineveh, which has more than 120,000 people who cannot distinguish between their right and their left, as well as many animals?" So chapter 4 is a coming together of the book. As chapter 3 ended with God showing mercy to the 120,000 people there in Nineveh, chapter 4 shows us that God is not only concerned with the 120,000, but with the one, with Jonah. Because Jonah is struggling with this, and God, in his grace and in his compassion, wants to help Jonah. It's almost like in chapter 4, God is sitting down beside Jonah and lovingly helping him think about what has just occurred and why Jonah has these attitudes that he's developed. God is not just concerned with the masses, but with the individual. That's consistent with the New Testament, where we have the parable, the story of the 100 sheep, and if one gets lost, the shepherd goes and finds the one. God is concerned with the 120,000, but he's also concerned with Jonah. We've talked about how in Jonah, God gives Jonah a second chance. Chapter 4 exists in our Bibles because God loves Jonah. And here we see God essentially giving Jonah a third chance. But it's stunning because Jonah's response is the opposite of what we would expect. The Bible says that Jonah was greatly displeased and he became furious. And that brings with it the idea of burning anger at what he considers to be a disaster. He sees the relenting wrath of God on the Ninevites not as a good thing, but as a bad thing. In fact, it's a disaster and he's burning with fury. He's not just passively, "Oh, that's not a good thing," or "I'm a little bit bothered by it," or "I'm a little bit upset about it." No, he's burning with anger over this. So much so, as we read, you saw, he despairs of life. This is a tragedy in his mind. Well, Jonah's feelings, of course, are rooted in what he believes about God and what he believes about the world and what he believes about himself. This morning, I kind of want to walk through what Jonah believes, or what we think that Jonah knows based upon God's word. We want to talk about what God does and how God proves his character and how God acts. Let's start, though, with what Jonah believes. What does Jonah believe about God? We see this in chapter 4, verse 2. He prayed to the Lord, "Please, Lord, isn't this what I said while I was still in my own country? That's why I fled toward Tarshish in the first place. I knew that you are a merciful and compassionate God, slow to become angry, rich in faithful love, and one who relents from sending disaster. And now, Lord, please take my life from me, for it's better for me to die than to live. What does Jonah believe about God? He believes some pretty amazing things about God. He says so here. Now, this is not a formula, but a pattern you see a few times in the Old Testament, and one of those is in Exodus. Let me read to you a passage from Exodus chapter 34, and hear the similarities between what God tells Moses about himself and what Jonah proclaims to be true about God. So Exodus 34, verses 6 and 7. The Lord passed in front of him and proclaimed, Yahweh is a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger and rich in faithful love and truth, maintaining faithful love to 1,000 generations, forgiving wrongdoing, rebellion, and sin. But he will not leave the guilty unpunished, bringing the consequences of the father's wrongdoing on the children and grandchildren to the third and fourth generations. What does Jonah know about God based upon his own experience and the teaching of God's word from previous? He knows, first of all, that God's merciful. He proclaims it. I know God, that you're merciful. Now, the word here that's used in the Hebrew that we translate as merciful, and some translations will call it gracious because it's similar in that context, it's a word in the Old Testament that appears 13 times, and every time it refers only to God. That God is merciful, He's gracious. So this represents God's attitude toward the undeserving. That God doesn't take an approach that if you're undeserving, I'm not going to help you. If you're undeserving, I'm only going to meet you with wrath. I'm only going to respond to you in a wrathful way. God doesn't look for those who are deserving. He doesn't look for the righteous to save. The fact that there's no sense or no truth to the idea that there are righteous people to save. It's only the unrighteous who need to be saved. If somehow we could muster up our own righteousness, we wouldn't have had to have been saved. God is merciful toward those who are undeserving. This might be Jonah's chief complaint. As you read this fourth chapter, look back over the first three chapters, this may be his chief complaint, that the Ninevites are undeserving. God, they don't deserve your mercy. Look at what they've done. Look at how brutal they are, how mean they are, how murderous they are. God, they don't deserve for you to show them mercy. And yet Jonah says, but I know you're a merciful God. Well, how does he know that? Well, he knows that, one, through personal experience. He's experienced the mercy of God. In this story, in fact, he experienced it. As God sends the fish to swallow him up and to change his heart. He knows that God is merciful. He also knows that God is compassionate. God's a compassionate God. God sees those who can't take care of themselves and who are suffering, and he desires to alleviate that suffering. Such as a mother would to her child. If you're a parent, you understand this, that when you have a child, and maybe you have that first child, it changes as subsequent children come along probably, but the first child especially, you have a particular view of them, right? One thing that maintains consistency with all your children is you understand that as young children, they cannot do anything to help themselves. They are helpless. Remember that first time you held your baby and that thought sat upon you very heavily that, hey, if I don't do my job here, this thing can die. Because it can't feed itself. It can't prepare itself for bed. It can't change its own diaper. I've got to act. And then when your child got sick for the first time, weren't you willing to move heaven and earth to alleviate its suffering? You know, when the child gets this stuffed up nose and you have a little bulb syringe that you suck the snot out of that. That's always a fun thought. I mean, some of you would probably think, hey, if I could stick a straw in there and suck it out to alleviate suffering, I would do that. Because I love this child so much. You laugh, but you probably would do that if it was the only way to alleviate the suffering of your child, right? God has compassion for the undeserving. He has concern for our suffering. We feel sometimes like we're alone in the world, but we must remember that God is a compassionate God. He cares for our suffering. You say, well, how were the Ninevites suffering? From any outward perspective, these were evil people. They were violent. Well, that violence blatantly violated the command and the character of their Creator. And so they were distant from God. And that's suffering. When people are distanced from God, God has compassion. He desires for them to come to Him. He desires to save them. He doesn't desire to go out and to just destroy people. That's not what He's about. He's compassionate. Jonah knows this. Jonah knows it from his past experience. He's about to see it again as God teaches him this object lesson. He knows also that God is slow to become angry. He's patient. The biblical word that we talk about sometimes is that God is long-suffering. God doesn't just immediately zap us or destroy us when we sin. Praise the Lord for that. We see this clearly in Genesis chapter 15, where God is talking to Abraham and He's promising him about the future that he will have. And He says, you know, your people, your offspring will be slaves in a nation for 400 years. And then they'll move along. And He says, these bad things are going to happen, but eventually I'm going to punish those who mistreat them. And there's a line in there that says, this will happen later, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. God is long-suffering. And He's waiting patiently. So when you get to Joshua and you read about the conquest and you think, man, there's some brutal things that are happening here, and that's true, but it's not as though God is quick to judge. He had waited and He had waited and He had waited and He had waited. And then ultimately, He punishes. Just as He had told Moses that He will not allow the guilty to go unpunished. If there is no repentance, there will ultimately be consequences. But He's long-suffering. Isn't it true that sin deserves God's swift rebuke and God's swift punishment? Some people see God that way. Some people see God as a God who's just waiting behind the bushes, preparing to attack them or destroy them or bring some bad situation upon them the first time they step out of bounds. And so they walk around being very fearful of God because that's how they picture God. But Jonah knows that God is slow to become angry. He's patient. He's long-suffering. He also knows that God is rich in faithful love. God's love is unrelenting. It doesn't stop. It's like this fountain that just keeps coming, keeps coming, keeps coming. And so God pursues, and God, He's unrelenting. As we think about the Scripture in Genesis 1 and 2, when God creates in Genesis 3 in sin, and he deals with sin, the rest of the Bible really is a story about how God has unrelentingly sought after man to reconcile us to Him through His Son Jesus Christ. That's the vast majority of the Scripture, God working to reconcile us to Him through His Son Jesus Christ, because He's rich in faithful love. It just doesn't stop. And Jonah knows this. He's experienced this, and he understands this. He also knows that God is a God who relents from sending disaster. He responds to true repentance. When people repent, God relents. And that's His desire, to relent. What's interesting here is not what Jonah knows about God, but the conclusions that he draws from that knowledge. Remember, I referenced Exodus 34 a while ago, and I read a passage that was very similar when God tells Moses who He is. Let me read to you verse 8 in that passage. Where, you know, so God has said, I'm a God who shows kindness, and I'm compassionate, and I'm loving, I'm paraphrasing here, and I'm long-suffering. Look at how Moses responds to it in verse 8. The Bible says, Moses immediately bowed down to the ground and worshiped. That's the only appropriate response when we understand who God is. To bow down and worship Him for His magnificence, for His brilliance, for His beauty, for His loving kindness, for all these things, Moses immediately bowed down to the ground and worshiped. But Jonah doesn't do that. Jonah does not praise God for His grace or His mercy or His compassion or His love or for His restraint. Rather, what does he do? He criticizes God for it. He even goes further. He says, God, because of all these good things about you, that's why I disobeyed. He uses it against God. Isn't that absurd? I mean, it's kind of like this. Your teenager comes in and you say, you know what? I just want you to know, I can't believe you came home a half an hour before curfew last night. And your room is absolutely spotless. And if one more time you show kindness to your brother, you're going to be in trouble. How dare you do these things? It's absurd, isn't it? But that's what Jonah does. I know you're compassionate and you're loving and you're kind and you're long-suffering. How dare you? Or your spouse comes home and you've been working hard all day and you come home and you say, you know what? This house is immaculate. And this dinner you have prepared is fit for a king or a queen. And I can't believe all the work that you've done in the yard. How dare you treat me that way? It's absurd. It makes no sense. And yet that's what Jonah does. He uses it against God. He says, God, this is why I went to Tarshish to begin with. This is why I disobeyed. This is why I sinned. Because I knew these things about you. In that way, Jonah 4 is a little bit complicated for us to get our minds around. Because it just doesn't flow logically. To think about that, we see it. And yet, I fear sometimes we have the same line of thinking in our own lives. Let me read to you a passage from Job chapter 40. You remember Job, right? Job was the guy who really did a lot of things right, was righteous, upright. God points him out, but God does allow Satan to bring him torment and suffering. And that book is largely about how Job deals with that and how he processes it and these friends who give him bad advice. And ultimately, Job kind of lets it fly and he questions God and God allows him to do that. But eventually, God says, okay, Job, it's time for me to talk. You sit and listen. I'm going to question you. You sit there like a man. I'm going to ask you some things and you're going to answer me. Not a very good position to be in, I think, but that's where he was. Listen to what God says in Job chapter 40. The Lord answered Job, will the one who contends with the Almighty correct him? Let him who argues with God give an answer. And then Job answered the Lord, I am so insignificant. How can I answer you? I place my hand over my mouth. I've spoken once and I will not reply twice. But now I can add nothing. And the Lord answered Job from the whirlwind. Get ready to answer me like a man. When I question you, you will inform me. Would you really challenge my justice? This is what I want you to hear. Would you declare me guilty to justify yourself? Do you have an arm like God? Can you thunder with a voice like him? And I read that passage in Job several weeks ago again and didn't think about it in terms of Jonah at the time. But I made a note, I wrote it down, and I thought, man, that's a powerful statement. Would you declare me guilty to justify yourself? That's exactly what Jonah does. That's exactly what Jonah does. Jonah says, God, you are so great, so wonderful, and that's why I sinned. Now, before we become too shocked at Jonah's audacity, we should take a look at ourselves to see if we have some of those same attitudes. Do we ever do that? Do we ever declare God guilty so that we can justify ourselves? I think we do. We might not just say it, right? We might not be as bold as Adam was when God confronts him about eating the fruit that was forbidden, and Adam says, well, you know, the woman you gave it to me. So he blames God for that. But here are some attitudes that we might have that we should be aware of as we think, do we ever condemn God or say that God is guilty so that we can justify ourselves? It might sound something like this. It might sound like, you know what, I was so bored that I sinned. I had nothing to do with my time. I was sitting around and I began to look at something I shouldn't have, or I began to think about something I shouldn't have, and that grew and it grew and it grew, and ultimately it led to a sin and destruction in my life. So aren't we basically saying there that God, your plan for my mind is ineffective? You're not enough to capture my imagination. Somehow, God, you're defective. Or maybe we say something like this, God, I wanted, so I sinned. There was something in my life that I didn't have that I wanted to have, and so I went through inappropriate means to get there, and I've sinned in that. And so through doing that, we basically are saying, God, your provision isn't enough. I still wanted something else, and I sinned to get it. Or maybe we say it like this, God, I was so lonely that I sinned. Which may be similar to saying, God, your plan for community and healthy relationship doesn't work for me. Or maybe we say, God, I was so afraid, so I sinned. As though God's peace and his strength are not enough. Or maybe we go so far as to say, God, I asked you for help. I prayed. I asked you to keep me from this temptation, and yet I still gave into it. And so we're basically saying, God, you didn't show up. You didn't help me. I think what God asked Job Would you declare me guilty to justify yourself? We see in Jonah's life, Job is saying, God, all these wonderful things are about you are true, and that's why. I mean, he doesn't say, even so, I sinned. He says, that's why I sinned. This is why I left to go to Tarshish. So in our lives, let's be aware of those attitudes. Because God is great, and he is wonderful, and yet we can sometimes declare him guilty so we can feel good about ourselves. That's what Jonah knows. What does Jonah feel? Let's talk about what Jonah feels. We see this in verses 1 and 3. In verse 1 of chapter 4, but Jonah was greatly displeased and became furious. I've already shared with you that has with it the idea of burning anger. And then in verse 3, and now, Lord, please take my life from me, for it's better for me to die than to live. Not only does Jonah not rejoice over the repentance of the Ninevites, that they're going to be saved from God's wrath, he says it's such a tragedy, it's such a disaster, I'd rather be dead. I don't want to live in a world, Jonah might say, where the Ninevites are the recipients of your grace and your goodness. I don't want to be around for that. Why is that? What would cause him to have such a reaction of anger and of wanting to not even live any longer? Well, it's hard to know for sure, but here are a few possibilities, I think. Maybe he has an underdeveloped view of God's kindness. He knows that God's compassionate. He knows that God's gracious. But maybe he feels like that's kind of just for him. The Ninevites were notoriously evil. I mean, they really were. They were known for their brutality. How they treated non-combatants in war, how they treated those that they enslaved, the people that they overtook in battle. But they were a feared people, hated. They were notoriously evil and brutal. So maybe Jonah looks at them and says, you know what? I'm going to make a determination that they're not worthy of forgiveness. In fact, not only should they not be forgiven, but they should be punished. And God, I don't want to go to them because when I do, you're going to forgive them and they don't need to be forgiven. And so Jonah places himself in the position of God. Anytime we hope for or rejoice in the punishment of others, we're acting in contrary to the character of God. Anytime we hope for or rejoice in the punishment of others, we're acting in contrary to the character of God. Now let me clarify that a little bit. We can and should and must love justice because God says we should. But we should also have a compassionate response for the perpetrator because God's desire is for them to repent. Does that make sense? We live in a world where the criminal justice system is important. Governments are ordained by God and used by God. And yet when someone has to suffer the consequence of, for example, the criminal justice system, we should not be haughty about that. We should not be happy about that. Rather, we should grieve for those people so that they can. So, grieving in a desire that they repent and be reconciled to God. That's what I mean when I say any time that we hope for or rejoice in the punishment of others, we're acting in contrary to the character of God. Let's not be a callous people who show no concern for the brokenness of those practicing evil or for their distance from their Creator. Let's be a people who see that with compassion, because that's how God sees it, desiring that they come to repentance and be saved. God is tender-hearted, compassionate. We need to take on that character as well. So maybe he has an underdeveloped view of God's kindness, that God's kindness extends even to those who are the most notorious blasphemers. His long-suffering, his compassion is toward them, ours should be as well. Maybe Jonah has an underdeveloped view of his own depravity. It's interesting that during the story, in chapter 2 particularly, we see that Jonah has received the personal benefits of God's loving kindness. Look at chapter 2, verse 9. But as for me, he says, I will sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving. I will fulfill what I have vowed. Salvation is from the Lord. While in the fish, Jonah comes face to face with his sin. And that's grace. That's God showing. Listen, anytime God shows us our sin, it's not because he's being mean-spirited. It's because he's being gracious. so we could come back to him, that he could pull us back to him. So Jonah receives it. He's happy about it, but he doesn't wish for others to receive that same kind of grace. He doesn't want the grace of God to be extended to other evildoers. It's for me. It's not for them. And so maybe he thinks that somehow he's deserving. Well, God, I might not be perfect, but I might have run from you to Tarshish, but I don't do what they do. And so his doctrine of sin and his doctrine of human depravity is off, not understanding the depths of his own sinfulness or the depths from which he has been saved, in his case, literally and figuratively. The Bible says that all have sinned, that there's none righteous. The fact that, you know, that Adam's sin has passed on to all of us so that we're all guilty. None of us have an excuse before God. James says if we're guilty of breaking one part of the law, we're a lawbreaker, and therefore we stand as lawbreakers in need of a Savior. We must realize that if it were not for the grace of God in our lives, we're all capable of unthinkable things. Maybe Jonah doesn't understand that. Maybe he thinks still that he was worthy of God to save him because he doesn't want the Ninevites to receive mercy. Or maybe Jonah does understand God's nature. Maybe he does have a correct understanding of his own depravity, but he does not understand the transformative link between the character of God and his own character. Maybe that's what's missing. As Christians, we should take on the character of God, not in his perfection, of course, but we should take on the character of God. In a very real sense, Jonah's actions, when he is acting out these thoughts and these feelings, he is being a false witness to God. Because God is loving and compassionate and long-suffering and relenting in his wrath, and yet Jonah isn't. His actions are not consistent with the character of God. Jonah would rather die than see God's wrath relent on the Ninevites. God would rather send his son Jesus to die on our behalf so that we can be reconciled to him. And so at some point, we just have to understand this basic truth that as followers of Jesus Christ, as those who proclaim to follow God, we must take on his character and allow his character to become our character. And so where Jonah is holding this bitterness and this resentment and this judgmental attitude toward the Ninevites, God has already passed that, and God desires for them to be saved, in this case, from his wrath. But Jonah would rather die than to do that. So there's something missing in his life. Maybe he doesn't understand God's kindness. Maybe he doesn't get God's or his own sense of depravity, his own sinfulness. Or maybe he doesn't understand that he's supposed to take upon himself the character of God. But in whatever situation, whatever the reason, here's Jonah just assumed ready to die. I'd rather die than to deal with this, than to live in a world where the Ninevites are forgiven, or to live in a world where the Ninevites are on God's side, or where God's on their side, I should say. So what does God do? Well, it's noteworthy that God doesn't, let's note what God doesn't do. What God doesn't do is strike him dead on the moment. Why not? Because he's long-suffering. Because he's compassionate. Because he's gracious. Rather, again, I vision God sitting down beside Jonah like a dad would to his son and say, let's talk. Let's think about what you're feeling. Let me help you to see the truth of this situation. In many respects, God gives Jonah a third chance. He gives him an object lesson. And in doing so, God proves his character. One writer says it this way. He says that God puts Jonah in Nineveh's shoes to help evaluate whether his anger is justified. God then does to Jonah what Jonah wanted him to do to Nineveh. God then does to Jonah what Jonah wanted him to do to Nineveh. God sends a plant to ease Jonah's discomfort. The Bible says in verse 4 that God asks, is it right for you to be angry? Now, one translation that might be a little bit helpful there is to think of it in terms of not necessarily morally right, but God is saying, is it helpful for you to be angry? Is there any good that's going to come out of you being angry? That's really the question God's asking. Jonah doesn't even answer it. He didn't want to talk. He's so worked up. He's furious. He's got this burning anger. He doesn't even answer God in verse 4. He goes out of the city and he sits down. And the Bible says he makes a shelter there to sit and to see what will happen to the city. Now, we don't know why. Maybe he's thinking perhaps the Ninevites, hey, there's no way this repentance will last. God is still going to destroy them, and I want a front row seat for that. Whatever his reason, there he is. And so God raises up this plant to provide shade for him. I'm not sure if you thought much about temperatures in the Middle East, but the average temperature for this particular part of the world, as I understand it, is about 110 degrees. Hot. And so God, in his grace, raises this plant to shade Jonah, to ease his discomfort. Now, God wants to ease his physical discomfort, but I think that God also wants to help Jonah with this internal discomfort, this inconsistency in his life that's causing him this despair. God wants to deal with it. And the Bible says Jonah was pleased with the plant. Hey, this is a great thing. This is a good thing. And when dawn came the next day, however, God sends a worm, and the worm destroys the plant. So now this good thing is gone. Furthermore, the sun comes up, and God appoints a scorching east wind. So the sun beats down on him so much, the Bible says, that he almost faints. And again, Jonah says, it's better for me to die than to live. The plant was great, but now it's gone, so I'd rather die again. And so God asked the question again in verse 9, is it right for you to be angry about the plant? This time Jonah answers. He's so upset, yes, it is right. I'm angry enough to die. And then God leans forward to him and says, Jonah, this plant which provided some comfort for you, you're so worried about it. You're so upset about it not being there any longer, but you didn't do anything to make it grow. It came and it went. Shouldn't I care about the great city of Nineveh, which has more than 120,000 people who don't know their right hand from their left, as well as many animals? See, Jonah was focused on his own comfort. His values were turned upside down. He was more concerned for his personal physical comfort that was afforded by the vine than he is for the spiritual and the physical well-being of this entire city. But God looks at them and says, I am concerned. These are people who can't tell their right from their left. Proverbs says that the way of the righteous is like the first gleam of dawn shining ever brighter throughout the night of day, or the light of day. Not so the way of the wicked. They don't even know what makes them stumble. So where Jonah has all this anger toward the Ninevites, desiring for them to be judged, God says, no, I don't want to judge them. I want to show them mercy. Why shouldn't I care about that? He also shows care for the animals, which is an interesting commentary about God's view of creation. So God here in this fourth chapter kind of pulls the lid back and lets us see the motivations. The story was never about Jonah to begin with. It's always about God. God wanted these people to repent. That's why he sent Jonah. In the course of the story, God teaches Jonah, and Jonah learns, but it was never about Jonah. It was always about God. So as we bring this chapter and this book to an end, let me make just a few brief comments about deepening our faith. This was going deep. That was the title of the sermon series. How do we deepen our faith from our understanding of Jonah? One, let's remember that God's grace is for me, but it's not just for me. God has extended grace to us by giving us his son, Jesus Christ, to calling us to repentance, by giving us faith, not because we've deserved it, but because he's a gracious God. He's a loving God. But it's not just for us. That grace comes to us, and we are to share it with others, not just in our community, but throughout the world. God will show mercy for all who repent. That's his desire. If we get to a point where we look at a person or a group of people, however we define that group of people, and we feel like we're writing them off, that God doesn't care about them anymore, or I don't care if they repent, I'm very happy for them to die in their fallen state and spend eternity in hell, we are not taking on the character of God. That person at work who looks at you with disdain when you mention coming to church, that maybe you've grown callous to, God wants to soften you to that person so you can see his vision for their life, that they would repent. That student at school who rolls their eyes when you wear your Christian t-shirt, God wants to soften you to them so you can see His vision for their life. That group of people that you've written off because you feel like they don't work hard enough or they don't do enough to take care of themselves so they can handle life on their own. They don't need my help. God wants to soften you to them so you can see His vision for their life. And when they repent, we need to rejoice regardless of how we felt about them before, regardless of what they've done. We need to remember also that faith is personal, but it's not individualistic. My faith in Christ is very personal, as is yours. That's why Jesus says, go into your closet to pray. It's between you and the Lord. But we live it out in a very public, communal sense. First of all, in the church, and then in our community, so we can shine as a light, that we're to be salt and light in our communities. So it's very personal, but it's not individualistic. And Jonah seems to have missed that, at least as it pertained to the Ninevites. Two more thoughts. God is not only concerned with my actions, but also with my attitude. Jonah did go, right? In the end, Jonah did go, but his attitude still wasn't right, as we saw here in chapter 4. God cares about our attitude. Yes, let's be obedient, but let's do so with a happy heart. Finally, faith is a journey. We continue to grow and learn, and God is always teaching. We see that in Jonah, don't we? Even when we think the story is over, God is still teaching, helping us as we submit our lives more and more to Him through His Son, Jesus Christ. Well, as we think about Jonah, not just chapter 4, but the entire chapter, I would encourage you to consider, does your life relate to Jonah at any point? Do you see yourself running from God? Do you see yourself in the fish, realizing more and more who God is and committing yourself to Him? Do you see yourself in Jonah 4? Having attitudes that just aren't in line with God and what God's character is all about. I want to give you an opportunity this morning to respond to some of those things. And of course, in any of our invitations, this is a time for you, if you're here this morning and you have never repented and sought God's forgiveness, desiring to be reconciled to Him through His Son, Jesus Christ, we'd love to talk to you about that. And maybe you're not sure what that means. I'd be happy to help you with that. Or perhaps you're here this morning and you'd say, you know what, Kevin, I am a Christian, but man, thinking about Jonah just helps me to see that some of my attitudes are real poor, especially toward certain people that I might not like or I might not appreciate, and I need to confess that as sin, and I need to ask God to help me with my attitude so that I'll see the world the way He sees the world. Maybe you're here this morning and you've been visiting with Linwood and this is the place where you feel God wants you to kind of plant and to join what He's up to here at this church. I want to give you an opportunity to do that as well. So we're going to pray in just a moment, and then we'll have a time of invitation, allowing you to respond to however the Lord's dealing with you this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come to the end of this service and we think about what we've learned in Jonah, it's hard lessons for us. And I think the reason that they're so hard is because it's somewhat of a mirror. We see ourselves in that. We see our own attitudes and our own sinfulness. God, I pray that You would work in our hearts and in our lives this morning to respond well to what we've learned, to give You complete free reign, not holding anything back. And so, Lord, I do pray that You would move in this time, draw many to Yourself. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Why don't we all stand? We'll sing and you come as the Lord would have you to do so.
Be Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Sleep.
invite you to have a seat. I'd like to invite our men to come forward who will be taking up the offering this morning. Just to give each of you an opportunity to give back to the Lord, excuse me, a portion of that with which He has blessed you. We don't really see this as an addition to the worship service. Giving is part of our worship before the Lord. So, Bo, would you mind to pray for us, please?
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies. Till all my fears are gone, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
I am a child.
Please be seated for just a moment. I'd like to share with you a few announcements. First of all, I want to remind you about the church app, which you saw promoted on the video. It's a great resource for us if you have an iPhone or an Android phone. And if you need some help with that or have a question about that, check out Guest Services. They'll be there to help you find where you can get it set up. If you have any questions about where to find content on there, we'd love to help you with that. So we think it's a great resource. Check that out. Also need to share with you, if you're not already aware, that Friday night, Annabelle McGraw went home to be with the Lord. And her services tomorrow night from 5 to 7 at McCombs here in Cape Girardeau. And then the service will be 11 o'clock Tuesday morning at McCombs. And then the graveside will be down in Portageville that afternoon. So be praying for them, for Marilyn Morgan, for her family as they grieve that loss. Let me introduce to you Evie Wiley and her mom, Lindsay. They have been talking to Pastor Mark for a while, and Evie recently recognized her need to give her life to Jesus Christ and to be saved from her sins. We rejoice in that, Evie. Very glad for that decision. We want to do everything we can to encourage you and support you, Mom, in helping Evie with that. She'll be baptized in the weeks to come as she understands that. But we're very glad to have you guys and have you, obviously, with your decision to follow Christ and as a member of our church. And welcome you all to come down and greet them as you leave this morning. Come back tonight at 5:30. We'll have our evening worship service at that time. God bless.